Hello, everyone, and welcome to Perky Pet's Birdwatching Podcast. Perky Pet can be found at www.birdfeeders.com. And I'm Kay Wagner, and on behalf of Perky Pet, I'd like to introduce Chip Clouse to our show. Chip works for the American Birding Association, and he holds two positions there. One, Director of Conservation, Education, and Outreach, and second, Birders Exchange Coordinator. Chip, you're a very busy guy. Today, our conversation is all about attracting birds to our backyard, and Chip is going to touch on four key elements that you can use to do so. The elements are water, food, cover, and a place to raise their young. So let's get started with the four things that we need to attract birds to our backyard. First thing we want to do is talk about food. So tell us about food and feeders.
Okay. Well, one of the things I like to tell people is that if you only have one feeder or room for one feeder in your yard, the best thing you can do is feed a mixed seed. Mixed seed has lots of different types of seeds that are attractive to different types of birds. But there is something that you really need to kind of avoid. A lot of these mixed seeds that you can find inexpensively have a lot of seeds in there that birds really aren't interested in. So I would recommend avoiding any of the cheap mixes that include things like red Milo or rapeseed or wheat berries. And quite often you'll see something called grain products. Not exactly sure what that is. But very few birds will eat those seeds. And with all of that waste that's building up underneath your feeders, are they really that cheap after all? I'd recommend looking at a high-quality mix that has a lot more sunflower and a lot fewer products that you really don't know what they are.
Okay, terrific. So if you can have more than one feeder, what do you recommend there?
Well, there's really five or so different types of feeders.
Okay, so we have the sunflower seed feeders.
Right. Black oil sunflower is the small black sunflower seed, and it actually has a higher oil content, a higher caloric value than the larger striped sunflower. Plus, the shell's a little bit thinner, and it makes it easier for birds like goldfinches and all to crack. They don't have the big seed-cracking beak like of a grosbeak or something does. And again, black oil can be fed in lots of different types of feeders. There's mesh-type feeders that have holes that the birds can just perch on and pull the seeds through. You can put black oil sunflower on the ground or in a tray feeder.
Okay, terrific. So, and then we have the thistle feeders.
Mm-hmm.
What are some of the details and benefits about those feeders?
Well, it's designed for specific groups of birds, essentially the finches. Chickadees and all will occasionally eat thistle seed too, but goldfinches, siskins, if you live in northern climates, red poles are very attractive to this Niger seed. And it's, again, like the sunflower seed, it's a very high oil, so high caloric value seed. These specialized thistle feeders have a small hole for that seed to be pulled from by the perching bird. And they also make these great little mesh thistle sacks. The birds just cling to the side of the sack, and they can pull the individual seeds through the mesh.
Good. So we have just a few more feeders to talk about, and then we'll get into water. But let's take a look at peanut feeders.
Peanut feeders are great. Again, it's just another source of similar kind of protein like a suet feeder would offer to woodpeckers and similar birds like that. Again, there's two types. Most of the peanuts in the shell are designed specifically for jays because a jay will actually eat the whole thing, shell and all. But the loose peanuts, peanuts out of the shell, to put into there will provide another food source.
So this takes us also then to squirrels.
Yes, we do.
What do we do about them?
Well, squirrels can be a lot of fun to feed. In fact, a lot of people will actually provide a separate food source for their squirrels, peanuts and all, and then put them away from the bird feeders. So in a lot of situations, people will do many things to deter the squirrels, such as purchasing squirrel-resistant feeders. One good example of that is the Squirrel Be Gone feeder, which is a really nice little square silo with a cage on the outside that's spring-loaded, has some very beautiful little metallic leaves on it. And as soon as a squirrel jumps onto that feeder, his weight brings that spring-loaded cage down and holds and covers up the seed ports.
Okay, then we have nectar feeders.
Yeah. above and beyond the seed-eating birds, we have lots of different birds, and obviously nectar feeders, most people think of hummingbirds, but you can also attract orioles and other things to nectar. So there's lots of different hummingbird feeders, and Perky Pet is very famous for all of the different styles of hummingbird feeders that they produce. I guarantee just about everybody out there that's ever had a hummingbird feeder in their yard to feed nectar has had a Perky Pet feeder.
So, Chip, for those of us who are starting out, maybe don't have as many bird feeders and are looking for a good product to get started with, what would you recommend?
Perky Pet makes a line of feeders called the 2-in-1 feeders that have these feeder ports that actually rotate to feed either thistle seed or like a mixed seed or a sunflower seed. So it's a really neat feeder that allows you to choose between the different foods that you want to feed. And so if you're not sure what you're going to get to your yard, you can start with one and maybe switch to the other. Or if you just want to have a little variety between feeding sessions, you can switch it out from day to day and just put different food in there each day.
And, of course, there's just one side note that I'd like for you to cover, and that is keeping these feeders clean. That's kind of an important area.
It's crucial. It's really crucial. When people just keep filling and filling and filling, if you aren't keeping your bird feeders clean, you could really be doing more harm than good. So I recommend cleaning out your feeders, at least monthly, and using some kind of a non-toxic soap or citrus cleaner or even vinegar and water to clean those out. And it's also important to keep your bird baths clean.
Speaking of bird baths, let's talk about water. Everybody mm-hmm. knows that part of drawing birds in are birds need water. They love water.
Well, the great thing about water, too, is that when you have bird feeders, generally you're only attracting birds that are interested in seed. There's a great product called a sippin' seed feeder that actually hangs from one point, but it's really two different things. One provides water, the other provides seed. So in that limited area that you have, say you live in an apartment or something like that, you can offer both water and seed hanging from one place with this sippin' seed feeder.
Let's talk next about cover. In other words, keeping birds safe.
Right. Well, obviously, birds that are seed eaters are not the top of the food chain. There are quite a few things out there that would be interested in eating them. And it's also important to provide cover to birds just to be able to withstand the element. A lot of birds that eat seeds stick around during the cold winter months. So providing cover for them is very important from the elements as well as from predators. Really kind of rounding out the talk about cover, when I mention the elements specifically, a lot of times people just leave the birdhouses up all the time. They might be surprised to find on a very cold winter morning, if they look out the window, they'll start seeing birds coming out of those birdhouses. And you know it's not time for them to actually be raising young. It's winter time.
Yeah. And most of us do think of birdhouses not just for roosting, but also for raising, you know, the babies. But
exactly.
There are lots of other places where birds can build nests as well.
Oh, sure. Birdhouses have a hole in it, and that's where they build their nest down inside of that. But other than birdhouses, there's lots of other places that different birds will make their nest. So if you can provide some type of a ledge, even as simple as nailing up a board under the eave of your house where they've got some protection from the eave above, but it's kind of open, then you can provide sites for American robins, eastern phoebes, sais phoebes in the west, barn swallows, cliff swallows, and other things like that.
Chip, we've covered a lot of territory here. We've covered four really critical ways to attract birds to your yard. You talked about food, water, and cover, and then we just covered about places to raise your young.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any final words for us in terms of for people like me who would like to learn more about backyard birding?
The American Birding Association is sponsoring America's first bird fair, which is a huge expose of lots of different small businesses, everything from optics companies to book companies to birding tour companies to bird feeder companies. And that's going to be held April 1st through the 3rd of 2011 in Valley Forge, Pennsylvania. You can find out more information about that at www.aba.org.
Well, that sounds like a great place to be. And Chip, I want to thank you for sharing your wealth of knowledge and all of those expert tips to attract more birds to our backyard. So for those of you who are listening to the podcast, if you're interested in learning more about what Chip is doing with the American Birding Association, please visit www.aba.org. And for more information about the Perky Pet product lines that you've heard about today, please visit www.birdfeeders.com. And you can also join the Perky Pet conversation on Facebook and Twitter. And also, don't forget to share those great photographs that you have on our Flickr page.